Well, we've seen how the West Indies came badly unstuck in South Africa. Now, almost immediately, they had the daunting prospect of a home series against the world number ones, Australia. Steve May has this report.
The script was all but written. Following their 5-0 defeat in South Africa, the once mighty West Indies were about to be consigned to the dustbin of history. The vultures were hovering over the entrails, and the selectors publicly criticised Brian Lara for his attitude and appointed him captain for only the first two tests. For undisputed world champions Australia, this was to be a gentle stroll in the park for new skipper Steve Waugh against an ageing and discredited team. The first test at Trinidad merely confirmed all these views. Matthew Elliott regained his place as opener for the retired Mark Taylor as Australia won the toss and chose to bat first. Left-arm quickie Pedro Collins was one of three West Indies debutants, along with Dave Joseph and Saroj Raghunath in the enforced absence of Hooper and Chanderpaul. Scoring runs was never easy on the Port of Spain pitch, and Ambrose and Walsh were in miserly mood. Merv Dillon made up the traditional pace quartet, with Collins, who took his first test wicket, when Slater tried to keep the score ticking. Matthew Elliott was doggedly defiant, but Langer and the two Waughs all fell cheaply.
Appeal for a catch of the wicket. Steve Waugh will go.
However, Greg Blewett was also adhesive, and with Elliott he raised the 100 before the left-hander padded up to Collins for 44, compiled in nearly 5 hours.
Blewett is a lovely driver of the ball on the offside. Consecutive overs, consecutive boundaries for Blewett.
Blewett soldiered on manfully, aided by Healy and then by Warren after the keeper was trapped LBW by the ageless Courtney Walsh, his 400th test victim.
Test wicket and joins Kapanev and Sir Richard Hadley in that elevated company, Courtney Walsh, 400 test wickets.
But when Blewett finally perished to Ambrose for 58 and then Stuart McGill went the very next ball, Australia were in some trouble at 203 for 9. Kirtley must have been licking his lips at the prospect of a hat-trick as he saw Glenn McGrath coming to the crease, but not even the Aussie fast bowler's best friend would have predicted the first miracle of this remarkable series. 172 test runs in 54 innings at an average of 4.5 doesn't exactly inspire confidence, but partner Jason Gillespie at least seemed to have faith.
And all the way, Collins can't get around in time. He's a left-hander, of course. It was going away from him. So that's the highest partnership of the innings now, as McGrath goes on to 24, tying his top score in Test cricket. More frustration here for the West Indies, not only on the field but off it as well.
Finally, McGrath went for a career-best 39, and the last wicket partnership had added a precious 66 runs, much to the annoyance of the West Indies.
Outside edge again, Steve Waugh does well. A chance to make a bowl in, an easier.
Raghunath's first test innings ended in farce, then McGrath trapped Sherwin Campbell, LBW. However, Dave Joseph and captain Brian Lara steadied the ship and gave the home team cause for hope.
Beautifully played by Lara.
He goes again, and that's a better shot. That is a much better shot, that is a six.
But Joseph fell immediately he'd reached his 50, and not long after came the turning point of the innings. Justin Langer's quick thinking caught Lara out of his ground, but TV replays suggested the wicket may have been broken without the ball.
But that was very, very good work. Ball bounced out of his hand initially, but he had the presence of mind to keep his eyes on the ball, gathered it and sent it back towards the stumps.
Still, Lara was on his way for 62, and at 149 for 4, the West Indies were certainly not out of it. But 12 overs later, they undoubtedly were, as McGrath and McGill proved unstoppable. 7 wickets fell for just 18 runs, with Dillon the last to go early on the third morning. Australia had an invaluable first innings lead of 102. Not for the first time since his recall, their effort to drive home their advantage was spearheaded by Michael Slater, whose breathtaking assault made a mockery of the tricky pitch. Just as at Sydney 2 months earlier, Slater seemed to be playing on a different plane to his teammates, and although his 106 out of 261 fell short of the 66.8% he'd achieved against England, it was an innings of equal significance.
Smacked just behind square leg, and that gives cause for the Australian flag to fly square leg. He had a bit more infinite, but he still pulls it away. And Michael Slater brings up his 12th Test 100 with consecutive boundaries. And four second innings hundreds in the last six Test matches.
Although Walsh's perseverance gained some reward with 4 for 67, the West Indies had a mountain to climb, needing 364 to win.
And that's what happens. So first ball in the first innings, second ball in the second innings, and another wicket for Courtney Walsh.
They never got to first base, as Australia demolished them in less than 20 overs, with Gillespie and McGrath bowling unchanged.
Gone to first slip, first ball with the replacement delivery, and the second wicket, a good delivery from Glenn McGrath.
Mark Waugh snaffled three catches at second slip, including Lara's second ball, and the Aussie pair exploited the unpredictable bounce to the full.
The West Indies 16 for 5. Here it is, and the man has taken three catches at second slip. And that is close, and that is out.
To make things worse, the West Indies' total of 51 was the worst ever in their Test history. The humiliation was total. The end was in sight.
All over the place. Collins, just a heave, West Indies' lowest total ever in Test cricket. Jason Gillespie knocks back the middle stump. Pedro Collins not waiting around at all. And the West Indies go one down in the series. A humbling defeat, an emphatic victory for Australia. 312 runs is the margin. It's the sixth successive defeat for the West Indies following their 5-0 loss in South Africa. Where do they go from here?
On to Sabina Park for the last rites, with a clamour for Lara's dismissal reaching fever pitch, and the Jamaicans, no fans of Lara because he'd replaced local favourite Walsh as captain, this would have been the last place he'd have chosen in which to fight for his future. At the end of the first day, all seemed lost. On another awkward pitch, Steve Waugh had blasted his way to 100 in company with twin brother Mark, who made 67. Mark's dismissal to the debutant Nehemiah Perry suggested this wouldn't be a pitch for high scores.
And the very first ball that Perry has bowled from the northern end gets him his first Test wicket.
This theory looked to be borne out by the run of failures that followed Waugh's wicket, and it took all of Steve's determination to get his side past 250 and himself to three figures. Walsh and Collins were the main wicket takers, with four and three victims respectively.
End of the innings, Lara takes a catch, Pedro Collins gets his third wicket, and Glenn McGrath is the one who is not out, as was the case here in 1995 when Steve Waugh got the double 100. He goes on an even 100 and Australia are all out for 256.
The final session confirmed the West Indies' worst fears. And again, it was McGrath and Gillespie, sensing the shattered confidence at the top of the order, who ran riot.
He's been given out. And he's bowled him! Inside edge, trying to slash it away through backward point.
37 for 4 overnight offered no way back, although Lara had survived, and that was a crumb of comfort. After the way the home team crumbled in Trinidad, Australia were no doubt sending a quick kill on the second morning. But Lara, at the very nadir of his standing in the game, chose this stage to display his virtuoso talents. Night watchman Collins survived 40 minutes before retiring hurt, and at 56 for 4, the obdurate Jimmy Adams joined his captain in a stand that was to reshape the entire series.
And Adams strokes it through the extra cover area.
Lara first played with great concentration. Then, as the score mounted and the partnership grew, he opened up.
And a superb shot from Lara for 6. Banged away through the offside, will go for 4, short, and Lara climbing onto it.
He tucked in to the much-vaunted spin twins Warne and McGill, as though they were net bowlers, and even McGrath was unable to stem the tide. This was the world's best attack, and it was being put comprehensively to the sword.
Very similar to the one he had earlier off Shane Warne, and this goes all the way for 6 as well. And there he goes again. That's another one.
Able to put it through for 4. Great shot by Brian Lara. He sat, he waited. Well played by Lara. That is brilliant. That's probably the most stunning piece of batting that we've seen today. And Lara decides to go over the top. So this could be the third boundary in a row. That is the third boundary in a row.
When he was finally out for a majestic 213 early on the fourth morning, the crowd rose to salute one of the great innings in Test history.
Lara leaves the field, a magnificent innings of 213, just one run scored today, and the fifth wicket falls for the West Indies, 378 runs on the board.
Jimmy Adams fell six short of a well-deserved century, but had the consolation of knowing that he'd shared in a partnership of over 300, which had restored the pride of West Indies cricket. As the leg spinners finally got some compensation for their mauling, West Indies finished on 431, a lead of 175. Better still was to follow. It was suddenly the Australians who played like rabbits trapped in the headlights. Off-spinner Nehemiah Perry celebrated his debut with a five-wicket haul, which included four top-order batsmen. Steve Waugh was clearly unhappy with his dismissal, although replay showed it was correct.
It'll be out if Steve Bucknor decides that it was cleanly held. He can go for the television replay. And Thomas Wilson, the third umpire, gives him out. Brilliant take by Ridley Jacobs. The congratulations there already belong to Jacobs. Out. He's got his fourth wicket. Greg Blewett has etched it. Brian Lara has taken the catch. And an appropriate way to end the day for Nehemiah Perry and the West Indies.
Day four was a formality, and in less than an hour, the game was over. Australia narrowly avoided an innings defeat, but the crowd were in raptures as Campbell and Raghunath joyfully picked up the three runs needed to ensure a famous victory.
Suruj Raghunath has the satisfaction of scoring the winning run for the West Indies. They win by 10 wickets. A happy man, Brian Lara. Happy West Indians, not only in the stands and in the dressing room, but also all across the camp.
Following the triumph of Jamaica, Brian Lara was inevitably reappointed as captain, and the teams headed to Fortress Barbados for the next chapter. Steve Waugh won the toss yet again, and had no intention of his team taking their foot off the pedal this time. But at 36 for three, Ambrose and Walsh were in the ascendancy. It was time for another captain's innings. Justin Langer models his batting on his new captain, and together they got stuck in, crafting a 100 partnership.
Waugh brings out his 50.
After reaching his 50, Langer was deceived by the first ball from Carl Hooper, now restored to the side. But this brought Ricky Ponting to the crease, playing only because of an injury to Greg Blewett. He wasn't about to waste his chance, and together, Waugh and Ponting built a big partnership.
Found the gap between extra cover and mid-off.
Lovely shot from Ponting, clipped it away in front of mid-wicket. That'll go all the way to the boundary, so another four for Australia.
The score passed 300 before the close, and with Waugh the more dominant, the partnership took the match right away from the West Indies.
Stephen Waugh has launched this, and that has gone right up on top of the stand. A big six to finish the over.
But just after Ponting had celebrated an excellent 100, a collapse. Ponting top-edged a sweep, and Healy, having waited a day to bat, was LBW first ball.
Stumps has given him out. First ball.
Waugh's concentration was momentarily broken, and he agonisingly fell LBW one run short of 200 after an 8.5-hour vigil. Still, a brief cameo from McGill helped Australia to a total of 490, surely an impregnable position, and they could regard Jamaica as just a flash in the pan. When Ponting continued his good match with a run out in the first over and three late wickets, including Lara, fell on the second evening, Australia was set to resume normal service.
Another short one. It'll be a big appeal for the Australians. Brian Lara walks. It's caught the glove, and that's a big breakthrough for the Australians.
The loss of Hooper and Adams with a score on 98 left the home innings in tatters, almost 400 behind and six wickets down.
In the air.
However, Sherwin Campbell remained steadfast, and with Ridley Jacobs began a gritty fight back.
That's his 50 with a full shot, and a determined 50 by Sherwin Campbell.
With Steve Waugh resting his seamers in anticipation of the follow-on, the seventh wicket pairing slowly began to milk the leg spinners.
He's got that through as well. And it's a long chase to that boundary and he won't get there. Crack that away for four more. The crowd's really enjoying this now. Oh, that's a gem.
Suddenly, the partnership began to look menacing, and it wasn't until over 150 had been added that Jacobs edged a slip for 68, the surprise bowler, Ricky Ponting. Campbell was eventually eighth out, having completed an excellent century, and there was even a tail-end rally from Walsh and Ambrose.
Good shot, and that'll beat me off.
Waugh eventually took his second wicket of the series at the cost of 199, and the innings closed on 329, a deficit of 161. But Australia were still big favourites, and with over 2 days to play, they had time to bat West Indies out of the match before retaking the field. But Courtney and Kirtley don't know when they're beat, and they had other ideas. Elliott made his third duck of the series, but it was the run out of Slater which turned the innings. For once, the middle order lacked discipline, and it took a stand of 53 between Waugh and Ponting to take the lead past 300. 146 all out was a big letdown, but 308 nevertheless represented an awesome fourth innings target, and it was surely too much to expect another miracle. Campbell and the inexperienced Griffith made a good start with an opening stand of 72, easily the best by either side in the series, but then a familiar tumble of wickets left the West Indies under the cosh at 105 for 5.
The breakthrough for Jason Gillespie.
Beautiful.
Swing it, swing it. Hooper can't believe the decision.
But Lara was still there and in imperious form, and Jimmy Adams again stuck around to help him put together a stand of substance. Having taken the score to 161 for 5 at lunch, the last day crowd were treated to a vintage afternoon from the young maestro. Lara's second 50 came up in just 51 balls. What dread thoughts must have been going through the Australian minds.
Ball spun back in a long way. It'll go all the way to the boundary. Magnificent cut shot. That is pure perfection. He's put it away for four. Doesn't the crowd enjoy that?
Beautiful shot.
No need to run for that.
That's his 100. Brian Lara hits it over the top. And the West Indies captain, the prodigal son turned messiah, gets his second 100 in successive.
Then, with tea approaching, Glenn McGrath ripped out Adams with a beauty, 238 for 6.
Ends that partnership with a beauty.
Jacobs and Perry followed in quick succession, and it was McGrath, already past 30 overs for the innings, who looked to have sealed the match for Australia. 248 for 8, and still 60 were required.
Number 6. McGrath has got another breakthrough.
But Kirtley Ambrose managed to hold out for a vital 12 runs, and more importantly, for 39 balls as Lara marched his side ever closer to the target in a nail-biting stand of 54. Unbelievably, McGrath was still going, but he was now well past the 40-over mark, and Australian heads were dropping. Then, with the winning post in sight, a pivotal moment. Ian Healy failed to cling on to a difficult chance as Gillespie found Lara's edge.
He's dropped it into his left hand and out. Lara tried to glide it past first slip.
Just 7 runs needed, but immediately Ambrose fenced at Gillespie and Courtney Walsh walked to the wicket amidst huge tension. A no ball and a wide brought the target closer, and with Walsh surviving 5 testing deliveries, the scores were level. Lara faced up to Gillespie with the crowd hushed, but moments later they'd found their voices again. Lara smashed a boundary to reach his personal 150 and complete a truly sensational victory for the West Indies. He had gone from being the scourge of West Indies cricket to the saviour.
So Brian Lara finished with 153, not out.
But this certainly has been a great test match, a great innings by Brian Lara and a great victory by the West Indies.
So incredibly, Australia went to the fourth and final test in Antigua, needing to win to square the series and retain the Frank Worrall Trophy. Warragain won the toss, meaning that Australia had won their last 11 tosses. Statistically speaking, a 1,024-1 shot. It would be surprising if War had not had stern words to say to his team after their poor batting, and certainly they looked very determined as they ground their way to a total. Greg Blewett returned in place of Matthew Elliott at the top of the order and compiled a very patient 32 before providing debutant Corey Collymore with his first test wicket. But no one ever got quite going, and when Ambrose returned to the attack, things looked distinctly shaky. Ambrose had enjoyed no luck thus far in the series, but now on his home ground, he was rewarded.
Hooper clings on to the catch. Gone, Hooper takes the catch. So for the second time for the day, Scott Hooper bowled Ambrose. There goes 232 for seven.
Steve Waugh survived Ambrose, and in Colin Miller, he found an ally who was prepared to put bat to ball. Miller, playing his first test of the series, whacked 43 off just 38 balls before becoming a rare Jimmy Adams victim. War was left marooned on 72 not out when McGrath's resistance was brought to an end. Australia took the field without vice-captain Shane Warne, dropped for the first time in his career after being savaged in the first three tests. His replacement, Miller, added to his contribution with the bat by removing both openers swiftly. All eyes were now on Lara, and it was clear he didn't lack confidence. Disdaining the more cautious approach of the Australian batsman, he set about the bowling with relish and raced to his 50 off 61 balls. Then, as if so high on adrenaline that he was unable to control himself, he increased the intensity of his assault still further and smashed his second 50 off just 21 balls, with 22 coming off a single over from Adam Dale, who was replacing the injured Gillespie.
And that is the absolute backing up batsman killer. Full toss. 95. So what can Adam Dale do now? He tries, he snaps it to the boundary. 99. Brian Lara goes to 99. That's the leg side, and it's in the air, but he'll be out the 100. He won't even look for two. So Brian Lara brings up his third consecutive century.
But having brought up three figures, he was well caught by Healy down on the leg side, without adding to his century. Local opinion being fiercely divided as to whether his innings were sheer genius or highly irresponsible. But with his departure, normality returned, and McGrath, Miller and McGill worked their way through the batting to leave West Indies 101 adrift on first innings.
And in front he's out.
This time, Australia were determined to leave no chink in their armour, with Slater and Mark Waugh both making important contributions. But the innings was held together by Justin Langer, who spent 6.5 hours compiling a top-class 127.
But the 100 comes up for Justin Langer. He turns around to check that Steve Waugh is safe, and well played at Justin Langer. His third test century. He came in again batting at number three, a position that he's trying to make his own.
Walsh and Ambrose continued their excellent and age-defying form by taking 7 wickets between them, but the fourth innings target of 388 was surely beyond West Indies this time. Inevitably, it was McGrath who made the vital breakthrough, first having Campbell caught behind and then taking the prize wicket of Lara.
Did he get the inside? No, he didn't. I can't do it.
When Hooper was trapped LBW by Blewett shortly afterwards, the only other potential match winner had gone, and for once, there was to be no dramatic final twist as the Australian bowlers worked their way patiently through the batting order.
Stumped. By Healy, there is a request for the television replay, but that's brilliant work down the leg side by Healy. He's being swamped by the Australian players.
Griffith notched up a maiden 50 in defiance, having early retired with a blow to the elbow, but the Aussies couldn't be denied. The final curtain came down as Collymore fell, appropriately, to McGrath. 30 series wickets for him, and as holders, Australia thereby retained the Frank Worrall Trophy. So a most eventful, extraordinary series ended in a draw, with the scriptwriters seemingly confounded at every turn. McGrath had pipped Walsh for the bowling honours, and Steve Waugh had shown his own form could withstand the pressures of captaincy. But it was Brian Lara who took the Man of the Series award for three brilliant centuries in huge adversity.